my great pleasure to now introduce our next speaker, Dinesh Manocha. He holds the Powell Grisman ICRA Chair in Computer Science and Electrical and Computer Engineering, and is a distinguished university professor at the University of Maryland, College Park. He is a fellow of AAAI, AAAS, ACM, and IEEE, and he's a member of ACM SIGGRAPH Academy and Vizier Award from Solid Modeling Association. He received a Distinguished Alumni Award from IIT Delhi and the Distinguished Career in Computer Science Award from Washington Academy of Science. He was a co-founder of Impulsonic, which was later acquired by Valve in November 2016. His research interests include virtual environments, physically based modeling, and robotics. And we are very happy to have this interesting talk here today. Thank you very much, and giving to you, Dinesh. I don't think we can hear you. We can see the slides though, but we can't hear anything.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, perfect.
Great, thank you very much for the organizers. So, good afternoon. It's really interesting to attend this workshop with different folks in different time zones. It's about 12:15 p.m. In the East Coast and U.S. So I will talk about some of the problem we're dealing with using machine learning for high-DOF grasping. You know, we've been hearing quite a bit of these ideas since this morning, especially at heard all this spotlight talk in the last 45 minutes or so, and it's really inspired by the prior work. So, you know, high-DOF grasping, ultimately the holy grail in robotics is, you know, someday we will have high-DOF hands, just like human hands, or even more dexterous as human hands. And these are problems, each of them is very well studied in robotics, you know, dexterous manipulation, we heard this term so many times today. Someday our home robots will come and do all the jobs we do in our kitchen, hand over this deformable objects like the soda bottle on the left, and pick and place, you know, the holy grail that Amazon Challenge has been picking up for the many years at ICRA and other conferences, Amazon Picking Challenge. So this is still the dream we all deal with. There'll be good hardware, but once it's good hardware, how do we go and pick and place any object we do? So the notion of grasping, you know, this is a classic pipeline. You know, I learned about this when I was a graduate student in the late 80s, and I'm sure that the pipeline has not changed. Use computer vision to localize any object. Pose estimation, you know, depending on the pose, how you do it. Then somehow the robot has to figure out how to grasp it. This is what I call grasp planning. And eventually, they execute the motion command for the arm and fingers and everything to move to do it, called motion planning. So this is the classic pipeline. And in this today's talk, I'm dealing with the grasp planning component. You know, of course, it depends on the left two modules, which are perception driven. I'll briefly talk about them, but especially recently in computer vision community, there's a lot of work on localization pose estimation, which has seen a huge improvements due to deep learning methods. But the focus is grasp planning. So, as I mentioned, grasping is not new. You know, as I say, I myself got exposed to many challenges of grasping in the mid to late 80s. For the lack of a better term, you know, if you look at the classic work, all this dynamics, force, friction, for the lack of a better term, it's model-based grasp planner. You model the physics, model the geometry, model the friction cone, uncertainty. And one example of this is something that we use in our work called GraspFit package. There are other Prada packages available, but you know, this is the kind of method you're given a virtual object, GraspFit can generate the pose for different thing. And I don't know if you can see the slide on the left. On the top row is a 4-DOF gripper, but on the bottom row is like a human-like hand with about 20 degrees of freedom. So in this talk, I really want to focus on high-DOF grasping because some new challenges come from it. Especially in the last 5-6 years, clearly there's been a huge attention on using learning methods, deep learning method, reinforcement learning methods, very active area of research. And I'm sure every time we go to robotics conference, we see exciting papers on this thing. The only thing I would say is that at least in our work, which we started more than 2.5 years ago, we found that most of the active grass lotting methods are for low degrees of freedom. So the focus of my talk today is high degrees of freedom, and I'll tell you what challenges come up in that context. So before I go deeply into grasping, I'll just spend 2-3 minutes. This is what you will learn, a little bit of review, maybe in your undergraduate class on robotics or even a graduate class on grasping. Because ultimately, you know, whenever we take these classic methods and when we design a network or a learning-based solution, we're trying to design a learning, you know, like a, some kind of a network or some more end-to-end unsupervised method, which is trying to model these issues of kinematics, range, friction cone, and grass matrix. So having this knowledge and using it to design learning is probably not a bad way to do things. So clearly we talk about degrees of freedom. You know, as I said, the focus of this talk is something like 20, 25 degrees of freedom. So you got the basic kinematics, you know, this is something you learn in the introductory, any take any introductory book on robotics, we'll talk about the second chapter, third chapter will be kinematics, you know, and all the way you deal with the degrees of freedom, especially on these arms. The notion of a wrench, you know, which is basically this we call WI for lack of a better term, the force and mass. And you can see how you place the grasp around, you place the, hold the object at different contact points. And based on that, you figure it's stable or not. Friction is a very big part. Now, there are a lot of friction models. I would say that some of the most widely used is friction cone, though some of my friends in physics will always argue that it's not the most accurate, but for the time being, I'll just stick with friction cone. If there are better models, we can definitely learn from them. And you know, you compute the friction cones at all these contact points shown as C1, C2, C3. And ultimately you take the range and friction cone, you know, and you compute what is called the multi-finger grasp matrix. So this multi-finger grasp matrix computation object is something, as I said, known since I learned in the 80s, and I'm sure the ideas are known even before that. So it's a very classic concept. And you're given the grasp matrices. So ultimately, in many ways, you know, this grasp problem corresponds to the computational grasp matrix. And finally, if you're given an object, you know, arbitrary shape, the grasp post computation comes out to be, you know, that is described by the grasp matrix and the friction cone. So the output is basically in a classic methods is compute the grasp matrix and the friction cone, which are, you know, do it. Again, I will not bother you with the notation, especially it's evening in Europe or late in the day, but just keep these two terms in mind, you know, the notion of grasp matrix and the friction cone. And there could be multiple contact points depending on how many fingers you have. And of course, what we've always told, you know, is try to compute a force closure grasp because, you know, it's more stable and it can, you know, resist any applied length. And there are a lot of criteria known for force closure grasp. So this is just grasping 101. Now that we all understand the terminology, so the thing that grasping has come up, there's a lot of work on different metrics, the Q metrics. And I'm sure I've seen surveys on different metrics. So I don't want to get the debate of what's the best metric. All I would say is that for this work, we use a Q1 metric. There are other metrics, we can plug it in. We're not really married to that. This is a classic metric. It was actually done by, when I was a graduate student at Berkeley in the late 80s, early 90s, John Kennedy was my advisor. And I still remember Carlo Ferrari was visiting from student from Italy. They wrote this paper, it's a very well-cited paper that defined the Q metric. So this is, you can see 29 years old, wonderful paper. I think it was ICRA 1992 in Nice, if I remember correctly. So that Q1 metric is you take the basically this convex hull that proposes metric. So this is the basis we're using. All our formulation is based on Q1 metric. A lot of loss function and things we have done. And if you want these other metrics, we can try them out, you know, but there would be issues in using them right there. So that's clearly the point there. So what I want to talk about are two different works we have done. They're both on addressing the problem of high-DOF grasping. First, we worked on a supervised method, design a neural network, especially taking into account some of the challenge of different loss functions. This was in IROS about a year and a half ago. And then last RSS, which was in 2020, which became online, we brought the notion of deep differentiable grasp planning. You know, this differentiable methods, learning methods, been a very hot area. It's been used in different fields. So we want to generalize those ideas to, you know, grasp planning and see what we can do. So it's most of the work is here. Both the papers are online and, you know, you can refer details out there. So here's the holy grail. You're given a, you know, some object on the left. You see this, you know, these boxes. We'll see, you could be given depth images or you could be given some occupancy grid, like a pose, a perception input. So this is what our robots see as input. In this work, you look at like a voxelization representation. And on the right-hand side, you know, we have this shadow hand, 25 degrees of freedom hand in our lab. You know, figure out the good grasp, you know, as you show this, and I'll show you a video of showing of, you know, picking up this, you know, box of sugar cubes with a high degree of freedom arms. And you know, you want to basically perform this computation very fast. So what really happens, you know, as I said, grasping is not new, and machine learning and grasping is not new. But if you literally go to take the previous methods and go towards high-DOF grasping, let's look at what they really do. First of all, you know, and if you look at most learning methods, they have this pipeline, you sample many grass, and then you score them with the grass quality metric. You know, of course, if I'm using Q1 metric, I'm claiming the Q1 metric is the best one. But previous method could not do high-DOF form because especially with high degrees of freedom grasping, you get too many valid poses. And that while it gives you redundancy and a lot of poses, it confuses your network. You know, having too many poses become what we call the graph ambiguity problem. So this ambiguity problem, at least we found the previous method did not handle it well. So this ambiguity actually makes it harder to train. Like just I showed this example of a bottle with this, you know, human hand. And you can see I'm showing 8 valid poses here. So on one hand, say, hey, compute any one of them. Of course, we can label them based on Q and metric and do it, but this is how things go. The second big problem is collision avoidance. You know, we don't want, you know, we want to compute a graph which is like stable and you know, at least in the virtual model doesn't penetrate and deal with all the inexact and all this valid grasping. So this is another problem. One is the height of ambiguity. And secondly, some of the collision avoidance problems get more complicated in the context of high-DOF grasping. So the first assumption we make, you're given some input. This is basically a computer vision pipeline, something that we just borrow from literature. You perform a segmentation on the object, which is getting pretty mature. There are very good solutions available in computer vision deep learning. We perform a simple Poisson reconstruction. And for this work, you know, we just assume we're given like a nice voxelization. You compute a 3D grids of voxels and you kind of occupancy. So given an object on the left, the sugar cube box, the representation fed to our network is this right-hand side, you know, this shape here. So this is the pipeline on the network, which I will not detail, you know, why we did this so many layers and convolutions. You can see the papers there, but except the input is this voxelization on the left here. And the output is the friction cone we compute. And then we kind of do a post process, like a post refinement, to make sure you know there are no penetrations. So computing a absolutely collision penetration free grasp with network is very hard to guarantee. You know, some machine learning has some limitations. So we said, okay, let's do the refinement based on, you know, after that, so that we guarantee it. So this is the way we overcame this problem was basically we used GraspFit to compute the synthetic data set because there were not too many data sets. And just to deal with this ambiguity problem, we started chasing lots of best poses. Again, best based on metric, and our metric is Q1. If you have some of the metric, you're welcome to use it. But imagine for each object, we compute lots of objects and lots of poses. And this could be a synthetic CAD model, or it could be the database available real world objects, you know, a bunch of them are available and you can use them. So, but the point is in our synthetic data generation, we generated lots and lots of poses for training. Now, this is example of, you know, how we do it. We basically compute objects on the top left and voxelization, we rotate them. And, you know, we try to basically do a lot of data augmentation. You know, these are just numbers done by experimentation, but the goal is, you know, with 100 poses, 27 different angles, we really wanted to, you know, sample the object from all possible positions and orientation and see what goes on there. So the real challenge was to design the network. And, you know, a big part of the network are the loss functions. You know, if you look at any deep learning paper, this loss function are somewhere the number of layers you do and the loss function are the two big challenges. So one was the consistency loss to handle it. And it has basically what we call it, you know, like a function, the neural network output for the ith object, which we try to minimize here with this difference, and the grasp ground truth. You know, you can kind of basically see the kind of function that the loss function we're trying to minimize, you know, what the neural network output given by the function f and what the ground truth would be. You know, this is what we attempt to do consistency with this thing. And this is the number of objects. We kind of normalize it over there. The second thing was the tooth long shank collision loss. So again, you're given a pose on the left, you compute this metric foxalization. And again, you have all the grasp points on the top right hand, you see with each finger and each link on the finger, you get the links and you basically go and deal with them and see what happens there. So this is a loss function here. Again, you can see what we're doing here is given the neural network output, the function F, the pose on the left, T, the function F, and you try to basically minimize it using a science distance function. You know, ideally, if this function is zero, life is wonderful, but of course, in the real world, it'll not be perfectly zero. This is how we try to perform with optimization. So this is just the details. Again, I will skip the detailed math, but the paper will give you the formulation of how it took the pose and perform this computation. So at the end of the day, you take this consistency loss for the ambiguity problem, collision loss, you combine them. And in this case, we do a simple linear, or even I would say convex combination of two loss function, consistency loss and collision loss. Of course, how do you weigh them? And there is no perfect method. We did some trial and error, and I'll talk more about this towards the end, which affects the performance. But the holy grail was to take the two loss functions, formulate them, and combine them in a manner to get good results. So this is just showing post-refinement. If you see on the left, you see all the friction cones at the contact points, but there are some penetrations on the left with the red thing. But with the refinement, the amount of pain, I would not guarantee you still is penetration-free, because high degree of freedom posed with the penetration-free by itself is a hard geometric problem, optimization problem. We did a lot of work on that. So giving absolute guarantee to the penetration-free are still not there, but we can significantly reduce the amount of penetration. So this is just the examples of this L2 loss function for the consistency. So we tried two different grippers, the shadow hand with 25 degrees of freedom and the popular Barrett hand with 11 degrees of freedom. And you can see, the residual on the training set on the right and the test set, So we saw the good thing was, the different residual of this loss function on training and test set was not bad, not too significant. And of course, you try different loss function, which is very typical in a deep learning paper. People want these kinds of evaluations and ablation studies. And you can find in our paper that there's a classic L2 loss, you'll see there, the consistency loss by itself. And the rightmost column is a combination of consistency and collision loss. And the beta parameter, the convex combination, we basically did it, you can see here, like at 0.75. So we put like 75% weight to the consistency loss and 25% weight to the collision loss. So this is one experimentation we have done. Different number will come up, but you can again see, how the functions are really behaving right in different settings here, right there. So other point is, the penetration, as I said, guaranteeing absolutely collision free. You want to touch the friction, but no penetration is still a hard problem with deep learning methods. And at least you see, if you just do the consistency loss, penetration is a little bit on the orange on the left. But if you combine them with the collision loss, that goes down significantly. So here are some examples. So these are synthetic data sets. We voxelize them. You can see the voxelized shapes. And so these objects you see, these four different objects, different poses. So this was not in our training data set. These are totally, the new test data set that we have not seen. And we do it here. And this is just comparing with like the best synthetic method. Again, one of the better synthetic methods, grasp it. Clearly you see the numbers. So this is the what synthetic method would have done, which is this, in some of the state of the art method. And you can see, what our pose method does. So, the results are, you can see the numbers for yourself and see, our numbers are of course higher. We can't be as good as grasp it right now, the training, but we're getting close to it. Let's just put it this way. But these are all the different shapes. You can see we tried the hammer, banana, airplanes with high genus. We tried a lot of complex objects, even the torus with something. And you can see, that this again, this is the examples of other example here, and this is the method here. And you can see, our method can really handle this method so quite well. So this is also very promising. And again, more examples, because any deep learning method has to do a lot of evaluation. We got lots of data sets. And again, you can see the graphs being computed here in the synthetic. We integrated with the shadow hand. You can see all kinds of, mustard oil bottle cans, apples, sugar cubes, and cups, and different objects. They're all new objects. And our method does quite well. So let me play a video here, and you can see it's acting. The video speed at 2.5 times. Of course, the actual grasping doesn't work as fast. This is 2.5 times slower than real world because the hand doesn't move as quickly. But you can see, you know, how we put the neural network integrated with a shadow hand, and you know, got the model of the object done, and it works reasonably well. That we are able to compute reasonably stable grasp. Of course, all the hardware are dealing with these big hands. That's a whole story. My students spending long nights and dealing with hardware. That's a separate big problem. But you know, you can go and grab this this plastic banana that what you see in like in homes. And again, you can see stapler. So we tested quite extensively. And you know, the fact we test a lot of synthetic and real world objects, including this, you can see genus one torus like shape of the duct tape. And it, you know, it can figure it out and do a pretty good job. So this was quite promising. So this is the first part. The second part is dealing with what are called differentiable grasp planning. You know, differentiable has been a hot topic in learning. And you got, in this case, I inputted a bunch of input images. You use ResNet. And again, you compute the friction cone and you compute the differentiable loss. So what does differentiable grasp planning, what do we want it? We at least had seen a lot of differentiable ideas being used other learning methods, but not so much in the grasping till about a year and a half ago. And you differentiable loss. So at the bigger sense, you know, it's an end-to-end algorithms. But the idea is that, you know, we use the classic forward, backward auto differentiation for each of the component. Remember I showed this kinematics, this collision and the grasp metrics. We use Q1. Now, one idea also comes with a metric which is differentiable. So we extended the Q1 metric from Ferrari and Canny, make it for that, for better term, generalized Q1 metric and make sure differentiable. Secondly, we'd make sure is that we have this sensitivity analysis optimization formulation, which can perform the derivative computation, like the first order. How do we do it? This is designed for multi-view methods. And actually, over a supervised baseline, having the differentiable component give us 22% higher success rate. So this generalized Q1 metric, I will not give the details of that, but it's basically extend the Q1 metric, and especially the coarse-grained metric here, but it really has locally differentiable even for an exact graph that we proved that. It's based on some optimal conditions. There's a classic paper by Joel Burdick in 1993. We built on that, the optimality condition, perform sensitivity analysis, and really get good results this way. So again, for the lack of detail, I'll just give you the three components is the loss function, there's the quality loss function, collision loss function, and the data on top of the differential metric, how we combine them. So the thing we realize in this quality function is, you know, is like the exponential damping of the quality metric. That's the key observation we really observe, that Q1 is our generalized Q1 metric, coarse metric, extension of Ferrari or Canny, but we take into account the exponential decay as a E minus Q1. And the consistency and self-collision loss are kind of similar to what we presented for the previous one. So besides the differentiability of formulation, here we add this quality function in this differentiable grasping method here. And the generalized metric, as I said, you know, one of the idea was to make sure, because having perfect touching gripping without penetration is not easy. So we try to make sure even if an exact grasp is not perfectly touching, you can still define the differentiability. And as I said, you know, the key idea was this contact range exponential decays, which we did in this quality metric shown right here. So this is what it comes up to be here. And this is how different metric comes out there. Again, this is the classic metric. Again, for the lack of time, I will not go into the details of that. But we take this, the range function here, take the top term. And actually in the generalized metric, we extend this by adding this, you can see this exponential component. This is what really the change we have done. And this is a metric we show has differentiable property with respect to inexact graph. That's what really makes us enable us to do this differentiability criteria right here. So this is the overall metric, just extension of Ferrari and Canny to generalized metric. Again, the bigger term extension is in this term to do this computations. And we get this upper bounds right here. So this is the you know, the different formulations here, which is again, the paper has all the details, you can see it. The collision loss is slightly modified again, based on the pre-version and the differential formulation, based on this exponential formulation again, with the beta term and the DPI, the distance term here, which is shown right here, again, based on the formulation. My apologies for going through details, but give you a high level idea of what's going behind the scenes right there. And the self-collision, you know, again, we want to grab them and as well as avoid the self-collision. So you can see we take a lot of sample points on the surface of the gripper and literally you know, avoid collision with them. So the two versions of this method we did, first thing, it enables us to compute a totally self-supervised graph learning. You know, so if you have even no labeled data, you know, on the top row, you got the initial rows of the of these objects, and on the bottom row, we compute them. So this is purely a self-supervised version. It works well, but at least, you know, this is probably one of the first self-supervised high-DOF graph learning. But in this case, you know, you can see, you know, this thing, but also we found out, well, self-supervised is good, but if you have a small labeled data set, like a small supervised data, we can do like combination of the previous version, which is self-supervised and small labeled data set. That's what we have done. So the, our best result, I'd say, is still taking the differentiable grasping, have the basic self-supervised pipeline, but at the end, we do bring a small supervised grasping data set and you get those results on the right-hand side. So again, you see even more complex shapes in this version than the previous version. And again, all implemented on the shadow hand, and this is all novel object. Nothing like this with database training in the small supervised data set, but you can see we can do complex objects again. And again, this is the same, we mounted the arm, the shadow hand on the UR10 arm. And you can see these are in some way probably more complex objects than I just showed you, you know, just 10 minutes ago in the supervised learning method. You quite see the pipeline is slightly slower, but we were quite happy that the method was working. This is the objects in our lab right now. Of course, we need a lot of real-world testing with lots of real-world perception problems. But you can at least see this is till about last summer was the state of the art in high-DOF grasping using this learning methods, supervised and deep differentiable. And then at least in this case, we don't need a lot of labeled data set. That's what differentiable grasping buys at right here. So this is it. Let me just try to conclude and see if you have time for a few questions. So I present you some ideas of high-DOF grasping. You know, first was graph was high neural networks. And the two problems we addressed was specifically to high-DOF grasping, the ambiguity problem and the collision avoidance problem. I presented both our consistency and collision loss function to deal with that. And we also generated the data set, especially, you know, we went for lots and lots of poses and lots of best graphs. So literally we had a very rich synthetic data set to make it happen, which clearly took a lot of time. And then we introduced one of the first version of deep differentiable graph planner using the classic notion of forward-backward automatic differentiation. Currently, all the differentiable properties, what we call the generalized QN metric. We have a basic unsupervised method, but we can also do a small data set and do a supervised version, which gives 22% improvement. While this results are promising, you know, there's still, you know, high-DOF grasping still is a challenging problem. It's going to keep us busy for a long time. Clearly, we are tested on simple benchmarks in our lab. If you go to the Amazon kind of packing problems, you know, there were many more challenging. We didn't have models of them. And also, I think we need more benchmarks. I think most of benchmark for low, but what is high-DOF benchmark for learning methods? We just tested the shadow hand in our lab. That's what we had. I'm sure many of you have much better hardware in your lab will do it. And then there's a whole discussion of metrics. You know, as I said, something we use Q1 because we found it simple and good and we could generalize it. But I'm sure some of you got objections to the limitation of Q1 metric, the other metrics. And the question remains is that for the first supervised learning method, we could do it. But for the second one, can we prove the differentiability property? And I cannot promise that. That depends on what metric you have. And especially in exact graphs, you know, in the first method, we voxelize the object based on segmentation and this thing. In second one, we assume you're given a lot of depth images, you know, and lots of depth images. And if you're given partial perception data, ultimately, you know, you want an end-to-end pipeline, which is right now perception done with one deep learning pipeline, grasping is done with them. Can we combine them and overcome this problem? And finally, with all the deep learning methods, including ours, you know, the parameters, the most dominating parameters we found was how do we perform relative weights between the consistency and collision loss? You know, most results are shown with 75% weight of consistency loss. So this is where things are there. There's still a lot of work to be done, and I don't know how much time I have for questions, but I'll be glad to take any questions or any feedback on the talk.
Thank you very much, Dinesh. Very nice task. We have indeed a question from the audience, and it's about cross quality metrics are well established for rigid objects. How do you think it could be extended to deformable e.g. textile-like objects, and most of all, how to use them then?
Yeah, that's a great question. You're absolutely correct. All our results are for rigid objects, you know, for high-DOF. And deformable object by itself, honestly speaking, cloth, you know, folding cloths. I don't have a, especially if I want a metric which is differentiable, I don't have a good answer right now. You know, so could we extend Q1 or something else? It's a good question. I haven't tested well enough and we don't have a good enough answer. So I would say that is still an open question at the moment.
Thanks. Maybe we can discuss some of that also in the discussion round. We just got another question from Martin Sundermeyer. Can the network predict multiple different grass per object and how much do they vary?
Yeah, so definitely, just like, you know, now remember network was trained on, let's say, taking 100 different grass. So yes, network could compute, you know, if you change the condition slightly, pose a little bit, it could output a different grass. And, you know, depending on the noise. How much do they vary? We have not tested well enough yet. But I cannot rule out the fact that you make a small perturbation in the input. Remember, you're given the depth images or some noise comes in the input because the network was trained on a large number of synthetic grass. So in theory, it can lead to a different output. Yes, that's definitely a possibility. And that again is something, how to make it robust because we don't want behavior. That is also a good point there.
Thanks. Then I have the last, like, more curiosity. You presented this beta, which was set to like 0.75. Like, can you give a feeling how sensitive this method is to this beta? Like, if you tune it differently, will it still work kinda, or like, how sensitive is this this weighing of the two losses?
Yeah. So if you if I pointed the paper, we addressed some of those issues. You know, again, you know, if a small change, but if you go from 0.75 to 0.25 or 0.35, you know, you can expect very different outputs. So I think, again, this is all this, you know, what you're asking are all this holy grail question in any machine learning solution where finding rigorous bounds and guarantees is always hard. So yes, for large beta, it can vary, but small beta, if you look at the paper, we have some experimental results on how beta affects the results.
Nice. Thank you very much. And we're going to hear more from you during the discussion round.
Yeah, they'll be at 30 minutes from now, right, I believe?
Yeah, after Jeanette's talk.
Yeah.
Great. Look forward to it. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the talk.